Circle First presenter here. Rick Lowe is probably best known for his project Row Houses, and last year receiving the MacArthur Fellowship. And he's here to talk about art in the built environment. So please join me in welcoming him.
Well, first of all, this is not going to work. I mean, so we got to get some chairs. Everybody got to come up here. This is like too weird. This is the weirdest context. This is like you guys. This is like a kindergarten class setup. I can't do that. So everybody in the back, bring up chairs. Because I can't project today.
Want to sit
today. The yeah, come on. Yeah, bring chairs up. Even the third row. Come on. You can't. I mean, you don't need your desk to write on. Come on up. Miss Blue, your row, come on in, fill in. You guys, come on, fill in. David Crossland asked me if I would do this, and we kind of lost communication on it. The last information I had from him was something about healthier, happier, prosperous. And then I finally found that today, and I was like, oh my God, what am I going to do with that? So I didn't know the context so well. So just so happened, I wore these pants last Friday when I did a presentation. And I got here, and I didn't know what I was going to do, and I was sitting here talking about it, and I reached in my pocket, and I realized I had my little thumb drive from a presentation that I made last week. So I'll do that in this context, because my session is actually art in the built environment, right? So we'll figure out where. Who was I speaking to last night? Okay. Well, I was speaking to a group at the Haas Center at Stanford.
Oh.
Yeah. Which also I did the same presentation actually 2 days ago at the City Lab conference. You know that's at Bloomberg Atlantic, the Atlantic and Aspen Institute. Yeah. So I did that. I've been rotating this. So. I'm gonna show you guys basically two projects that I've worked on, just to give you a sense of how I approach art within the built environment, and then maybe we can tease out what that means together in terms of healthier, happy, and prosperous communities. And so the first one, how many of you have been to Project Row Houses? So a few of you have, so I don't know why I'm not moving. Oh, okay, here we go. All right, so just to give you a little background, my work in the built environment kind of starts with Project Row Houses. Came out of my work as a painter who was making paintings and installations that dealt with political and social issues. But then I was challenged by a young student that said that while the paintings and things I was doing reflected what was happening in the community, it wasn't what they needed, because everybody lived that experience. So he said, if you're creative, why can't you create a solution? And so that forced me to reconsider how I went about my work and trying to figure out how to produce something that both symbolic and poetic, that had an artistic element of satisfaction for me, but also had a practical application in terms of improving communities on the other hand. So it started out with these little houses here. Now, I discovered these houses when I was on a tour with a group of activists who had pulled together a busload of city and county officials, driving them through the third ward, which is just northeast of here, driving them through the neighborhood, pointing out dangerous places that they wanted torn down. And they went all over the neighborhood, and they stopped at this set of houses, which is 22 little shotgun-style houses on a block and a half. And then the remaining parts of that, kind of almost like a four-block area, there were only three buildings occupied. So they wanted to have the city tear everything down and start over, because it was just a cluster of environmental hazards, you know, that was taking place there. And I agreed with them in the beginning, but then I started coming up with this idea of maybe trying to figure out how to transform it into something that, in an artistic way, that would take something that had no value and try to infuse, you know, some kind of symbolic and practical value to it. And so these were what they started out like, and this is just kind of show you the context of where we are. We are, it's about two and a half miles from the business district area, and these in the forefront of the little old houses that we started out with. And then over time, after spending time, you know, trying to reclaim these old houses and position them as having some kind of cultural and historical value, we also realized that it was a catalyst for reshaping the way that people think about the entire neighborhood, right? To have history as a major component of its revival. And so we involved ourselves in designing new houses that fit with the existing structures. We have a long-running partnership with Rice University of Architecture, in which we work with most of our newly designed work. And so inclusive of the project is art and cultural activities, but there's also education and social service programs. And I just show this slide as one that just kind of shows one element of some of the programs there. This is our transitional housing for single mothers. Now, most people always say, you know, well, what is that? What is, you know, how does the single mothers have to do with art? Well, our thing is that, you know, in the process of rebuilding or building in general, I mean, it's a creative process. You get your best results when you're engaged in it creatively. And so our challenge was to figure out how to develop a social service program that worked almost the same way that an artist put together a painting or a sculpture, right? You know, you're always trying to make every brush stroke count. In sculpture, you're trying to make every, you know, chisel mark or whatever counts. And so the point was to try to translate that thinking into the lives of these young mothers, that every day, every decision they're making, they're sculpting their life in a way that's going to either make it something that's beautiful or it's going to be, you know, it's not going to be so good. And so we try to use that artistic language throughout the programs, everything that we do. And so this is, it's a transitional program for single mothers that get to live there for a year to 2 years. The thing I want to point out, though, is this person here. I have them on here because she was one of the first to be in our Young Mothers program, and really shows the beauty of the transformation of individual lives. And she came into the program as a very troubled person, and ended up finishing her schooling at the University of Houston, going off to Penn State to get her PhD. She got her PhD, and she taught at the University of Pittsburgh for a few years. She came back to Houston, and was talking to the mayor about her story, and the mayor was very interested, so she ended up appointing her to the board of the Houston Housing Authority. And, you know, and she's just blossomed into this great leadership role that's pretty amazing. In fact, actually, she's probably 20 minutes into her presentation right now at MIT. But so she is, it's 3 o'clock. Yeah, her presentation is 3 years. So. Anyway, so that's this, you know, that's one of the program elements of the project. Now I'm gonna shift a little bit and tell you a little bit about another project that I've been working on. in Dallas that's a different kind of application of art and community building. But this project came about through an exhibition that I was a part of at the National Sculpture Center. And they were doing their 10th year anniversary, and they asked 10 different artists to do projects in different parts of the city. And they asked me because my interest is in community building. And so I agreed, and they took me to several neighborhoods. And the one that struck me the most, that was most interesting, was this one. It's called Vickery Meadow. And it's a interesting little neighborhood because there's nothing physically interesting about it other than really if you see it and the description of it, it's one that you just think is one of the most terrible, you know, it's like the bad design phase of America, right? In the 1960s, 70s, the garden apartments, you know, where they're really designed for people to, you know, drive into their apartment complex parking lots. You know, they have the swimming pools and that kind of stuff. And then when they get ready to do something in the city, they get in a car and they drive out. So there are rarely any, sidewalks or no public amenities. people don't really live in these garden apartment areas. They sleep there, you know, and they maybe watch TV, but they have to do all their other stuff in different parts of the city. Well, this area of Vickery Meadow was built as a community in the early 1970s with some 15,000 apartments. So it's very dense. And over time, with depreciation, lower income people start to move in. And families start to move in. Originally, it was built mainly for kind of recent graduate, middle class whites. But then as more lower income folks start to move in, families and so on and so forth, it started to go down. And most of the people kind of just talked about the violence of it. I'm missing a slide for you. Okay, anyway, most of the people would talk about that it's just become a violent place, mainly because in the late 90s, early 2000s, the International Refugee Committee chose that neighborhood as a place to, to put refugees. Basically, because it's such a large number of apartments, and there's always enough vacancies that you can get people in. So, so by the hundreds, there are like these new refugees or immigrants that are kind of floating in. And so there's this sense that there's violence coming with all these refugees. And I, as an artist, I kind of start thinking about the contradiction of in that we generally think that we always champion diversity, in our society we think diversity is great. But this has turned out to be one of the most diverse neighborhoods I've ever been in. But it was thought of as completely negative, and bad. So it's like how do you work out that kind of difference? And so as my investigation led me to basically, people saying that it was so violent that they just needed more police, more and more police. And so they were constantly, most of the budget for their improvement district was spent on, policing and so on and so forth.
Is that in Oak Cliff?
No, it's in kind of, they call it North Dallas, but it's not far North Dallas. It's just outside of, kind of north of SMU. Yeah, north of SMU, about a few miles, and it's on Park Lane, which is where North Park Mall is here. Yeah. Anyway, so they were spending all the resources on policing, and convinced that that was the only way you could deal with the violent nature of the neighborhood. But I actually went to a meeting that a couple of women, a couple of social service groups had put together. That was pretty amazing. They called it the Mom's Lunch. And they were trying to push back on the idea that all the violence came from this, violent people. And they said, maybe it's because people don't know each other, and they don't have a way to get together, and so on and so forth. So to have this Mom's Lunch, in which they would have about four or five women from five or six different countries, and they would sit there in the circle, and they would tell stories about, you know, their lives, their families, and so on and so forth. And I managed to get them to let me come to one and sit there. It was one of the most amazing, it was almost like, as a person sitting and watching, it had this kind of theatrical quality because the stories were so deep and heartfelt. And then, but watching how it happened through the translation of all the languages, you know, so when one person told a story, it had to be translated into English, and then it was like translated back out into the group with all these different, you know, so it was really quite, you know, amazing. And I thought a really great art project would be one that could amplify that in a way that that was respectful, though, of, you know, the cultures of the people that were there. And so we came up with this idea of, well, it came to me that a lot of the ways that people in third world countries come together is through markets, right? And that's the way people in general, people don't, you know, know each other. They meet through transactions and stuff. And so I put together a team of people, and we kind of went from community meetings on the streets, meeting people and asking, you know, trying to figure out if we could do a market, if it would work. And so we had this, we ran into the idea of like, so what do you put at the market? And we wanted to have things that people in the community made. So we ended up getting some apartments, vacant apartments donated to us, and we set up workshops where we would teach art making workshops to people in the community, but hoping that we would find people who were refugees and immigrants who were also artisans themselves. And it didn't take very long that once we started, all of a sudden, people from all over were showing up, and they ultimately end up leading the workshops. So then once we start getting things together to actually have the market, we thought, you know, how do we approach this? Because everybody was warning us. The museum was very nervous, saying, you know, the reports that we get are that people are not going to come together inside the neighborhood because they don't know each other, they don't trust each other. And certainly people from outside of this neighborhood is not going to go in. And they were worried about their art patrons going into this area. And so we did our first event. We wanted to test it, and we had something we called the Lucky Pot, because we thought maybe food would be the thing that would get people together, and hoping that we could get maybe four or five different, you know, folks to do food in different groups. But as we started to meet with people and talk to people, there was an overwhelming amount of people that were interested. And so we pulled together our first little market for the Lucky Pot. And we had 19 different countries, food from 19 different countries represented. And to our surprise, you know, I mean, people from all parts of the neighborhood just kind of walking and coming in, and all of a sudden it was this kind of thing that actually one of the best testaments that we had to this effort was that prior to actually doing this event, when we were getting ready for it, there were a couple of young African Americans, you know, guys walking through, and they were kind of being, you know, having a little gang-like thing going on, you know, no shirts and sagging pants and all, and like asking us if we were going to be selling Kush, you know, as a drug, whatever. And we're like, no, we're not doing that, you know. And like, well, you guys don't know what you're doing. You need to just get out of here, whatever. And once we did this event, though, and it was like this, and we were cleaning up that evening, and one of the guys came back. And when he came back this time, it was really weird. He looked like a young boy, young kid, right? Before, he looked, had this kind of gangster thing. But he came back, and he knocked at the door, and we opened the door, and he was like, you know, I just wanted to come back and say, you know, I didn't come to this thing today, but I live right across the street, and I was looking out the window, and it was like, we never had anything like this in our neighborhood. You know, he was like so, you know, blown away, and he became one of our biggest supporters in the way that this project has moved forward. So after we did this initial one around food, we wanted to figure out how we get actual options and things to the market. And so another idea came up with was to allow people the opportunity to show their talents and performances. And so all of this, though, we're designing it based on the empowerment of people within the community to speak for themselves and not for us to kind of do it. We take the lead on, you know, kind of positioning things, but only in a way that it allows the people there to kind of come in and move things forward. And so all of it, so this little area that most people thought was very dangerous and not a good place, all of a sudden it became kind of a little meeting ground, meeting area within the neighborhood where people were coming, performing music. This is throughout the week, and children would come and hang out. And then we had our next event, which was called the Victory Meadow Has Talent. And once again, it was one of those situations where we were trying to figure out, you know, how this would work. And you know, we had about 26 performers. These are monthly markets that we host, and 26 performers ranging from, you know, a 18-month-old little girl from Somalia, kind of doing a little cute dance, to an 86-year-old white guy doing a hokey pokey. and then, like, so many different things in between, right? Black gospel, Aztec dance, Bhutanese dance, and singing, and all these different groups. And what was the most interesting thing about it, you know, was to be able to sit there and watch, like, you know, a group of older women from Bhutan watching these young African-American hip-hop dancers, and then vice versa, right? You know, so having these, you know, and watching people kind of, you know, learn how to appreciate and the diversity of culture within their neighborhood. So this is, you know, this is just more, and also the thing that this project was also showing was that there was a false assumption that people would not come together. I mean, you give them the right context, they will. And then, and also the people from outside of the neighborhood were very much so involved in this. Now, and then I'm just gonna finish with a little part that we ended up doing because we wanted to activate the entire street of the neighborhood, because, as I said, there was no public infrastructure, no public space along in the interior of the area. I mean, you have like bus stops with just the little, you know, sign or whatever, but nothing where people would kind of walk along, gather, get to meet each other, and so on and so forth. And we also had a challenge that there were many artisans that were that we were discovering that had talents and skills that deserve a better presentation than just being in a market on a table. So we started trying to figure out how do we provide that. And we thought about getting more apartments and, you know, whitewashing them so that we could do exhibitions in them. But then I was talking to a friend of mine, an artist from LA, Mark Bradford, whose work is on this wall here. This is from Mark's first exhibition at a gallery in London. It's called White Cube. Anybody know White Cube in London? No. It's interesting that, you know, this gallery is kind of distilled what holds value in art to the white cube. It's about the presentation. It's kind of like, you know, when people say you put things on a pedestal, that makes it valuable. You put things in a white cube, that makes it valuable, right? And so Mark's work in this show was the first time some of his work went for over $1 million. And when I was talking to him about that, and I was like, it's like, we need some white cubes in this neighborhood, you know, so that we can, you know, I mean, can we get some, can we make them special like that? And so I went back to Dallas and met with a group of architects, and I kind of challenged them. I said, you know, how can we have white cubes in this neighborhood? Something that would play off of the white cube thing in London, but would be something that's just a little box that we can show things, you know, in this area. And so they took the challenge and came up with these little structures that became little gallery spaces, but also spaces for public interaction. So because they're along the street where there's generally not a lot of activity that happens. So exhibitions happen in them, but also sometimes they serve as like bus stops. You know, when people wait on the bus, it's raining, they go and hang out in the cubes. And so this gave us opportunity to do all kind of exhibitions, people from inside the neighborhood, outside the neighborhood, and so on and so forth. So I think I'm gonna stop here because what I've shown you is two different examples of how, you know, through my practice, art, you know, has an impact in the built environment. On the one hand, you know, with Project Pro Houses here, it's about, you know, trying to figure out how you contextualize a neighborhood within its historical context in a way that not only, you know, captures the history of the buildings, but also create opportunities for the community and the people that live there in the ongoing development. So that's our that's Project Grow Houses. But then the project in Dallas is really trying to challenge the city, the property owners, and in that community to kind of think forward about, you know, the changes that have happened, the different contexts. That community can no longer sustain itself as a garden apartment area because of all the refugees and immigrants. And so how do you respond to that? So that's been our approach in both those examples. So I'm going to stop there, and we can have a little conversation if we have some time. So we have a question here.
How has receiving the MacArthur Award, which ended up being with money, changed your work?
It hadn't really changed my work. It hadn't changed my work. It has kind of changed the, it's changed a couple things. One is access. You know, I mean, it does increase access to people. You know, people, they brand that award really well, right? That, you know, that when somebody was saying, you know, you no longer need anything else in your introductions. You know, you just say MacArthur Fellow, you know, and that's all you got. And but it allows that. But I also think that it increases the pressure, though, because with that access, you know, it's access for me, but you have to spend time to access things, right? So whereas, you know, a couple of years ago, I considered myself really busy when I was, you know, traveling here and there. I had, you know, a couple of projects that were going on, and you know, here, Dallas and Philadelphia, and that kind of stuff. You know, so it's just kind of, you know, it was manageable. And now I'm finding myself in a situation where it's kind of getting a little bit crazy.
You know, so busy.
Yeah, it's kind of almost too much to do the work. And I'm a little concerned about that, though, about, you know, kind of, you know, the demands become a little bit more than.
Do you have to report back to the company?
No. Well, people always ask that, but let me tell you, I mean, it's one of the strangest award programs, and if, you know, if we could have funders that give us grants like this, it would be amazing. Where, you know, it's just a phone call and an email asking you for your banking information. No meetings, no nothing. In fact, they don't even know how to honor their fellows because they're trying to put together something to do a 35th anniversary celebration, but they've never done anything to acknowledge that program, so they don't even know what to do.
But I'm just wondering how you would translate the approach that you just talked about to something like what we've been talking about in the conference, where we have all these different nonprofits and state and government organizations that need to cross-pollinate, get out of their silos, and do wonderful things to communicate and create great things.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think actually, I mean, I haven't been at the conference, so I don't know what you guys have been talking about. But I understand that what the question that you're asking is, I mean, it's the question of the century, right? You know, it's like, how do we figure out how to leverage each other, you know?
Yeah, and connect.
Yeah, and work with each other. And, you know, and working over time is really interesting how, I guess things happen for different reasons, but if I think about it in hindsight, when I started Project Grow Houses, to start over again, I probably would have tried to do some of the programs that we initially started with partners instead of us doing them ourselves. Like, so when we started out as an arts group, right, so we had arts and cultural programming, then we started an education program, then we started a transitional housing program for single mothers. Then we started a housing development corporation. And so we were doing all these things ourselves. And as I've, you know, over time I've realized the reason that we were doing it is something that I advise people against now, is that you're doing it because you don't have a level of trust that other people will understand, you know, what you're doing, and are able to do it the way that you would want to do it. And the more I do this work, the more I realize that trust, you have to give trust. You know, you have to give it up, you know, particularly on to do things on a larger scale. And so so currently Project Grow Houses is kind of leading an effort for broader development in the northern, the northeast, I mean northwest portion of Third Ward. And intentionally, right, we're instigating and leading the process, but we're encouraging all the other partners to take lead roles, because we know we're going to do the work. But having, you know, the pastors at the churches be the chair of this new effort, it means that they, you know, there's a buy-in here, you know, giving them the opportunity, and or at least creating a context in which they can actually, you know, dig in. Because otherwise, if we keep leading it, we leave people out. So that's the lesson that I've learned over time. One year. That's a good question, because this project started 3 years ago. And you know, it started as a project of a museum, right? So it was in the context of an exhibition. So, but the exhibition is over. So now it's like, how do you continue a project like this? And so the thing that we've been doing is building, trying to integrate the things that we're doing into number of the partnerships that we developed throughout. And so fortunately we have some really good partners. I mean there are loads of people that are, because when you have something like, I think in that neighborhood, they guess that there's somewhere around 33,000 to 35,000 people, right? And in terms of refugees, there's something like 8,000. I mean, it's a lot of, you know, I mean, there's loads and loads of folks there. And so there's a huge interest from, you know, different entities trying to figure out how to address it. And so we've been able to kind of position ourselves as a value add to other organizations who are now supporting us. Here, back here.
So that was, I think, built in on the
speak up a little bit?
Sorry, yes. Referring to actually both projects and the issue of kind of that level of trust. So there were partners involved, and I guess one of my questions would be too, from people who are not necessarily directly affiliated with some of those partner organizations, are you beginning to kind of see a little bit of that grassroots leadership emerging, or people in pockets of those starting to kind of take ownership of this and think about taking it in different ways with that?
Well, I mean, right now the you know, I mean, I have a young person I mentor who's, you know, taking the project and moving along. And she's doing a great job, you know, because she's there full time and she's able to kind of, you know, work with folks. But one of the key issues though is empowering neighborhood leadership. And the challenge around that though, often, particularly because most of the people that are gravitating towards our project and our program are the immigrant and refugee communities. And so there are those dynamics, cultural dynamics here that, you know, that makes the leadership part a little bit difficult. But that's on the plate though for the future, is figuring out, you know, how do we get that leadership and also leverage the immigrant leadership there in the context of the partners that are, you know, that are focused. should go visit. It's translation.
It's funny because I actually know there are a couple people that I'm sort of connected with through my husband actually who live there. So
oh.
It's kind of. Yeah. But yeah, so I knew there were other things kind of going on bubbling, but I had no idea there was this whole art component to it too. So.
Google translation Victory Meadow, and it'll come up, and then you can go to our. We have a studio space in the 5 point area.
I hope it makes sense as I drag everybody through this question, but I think it'll be worth it. A lot of what we're talking about here is walkable urbanism and safe walkable neighborhoods, which is what Houston used to have. And so my friend Megan Loreno, who works with neighborhood centers, did a lot of work in Fifth Ward with elderly people, and asked them, what do they really want? What do you need? And the overwhelming answer was stuff. We used to have stuff. And we used to be able to walk to Main Street, and there was a theater, and there was a club, and there was music, and there was a store. And so I've been saying lately that a lot of what I'm talking about is restoring. Most neighborhoods in Houston need to be like Third Ward was in 1930. And so that specifically, the intersection of Elgin and the street formerly known as Dowling. you know, that used to be the center of that neighborhood and had an active life. And so I wonder how that fits in your vision of the board. We have, and to some extent you've been doing it at the place there, but can we have other small businesses and things?
Yeah, we have our challenges there. And thank you for the street formerly known as Dallas Street. For those of you who don't know, one of the main streets that runs through the western part of Third Ward is Dowling Street, which was named after a Confederate officer. And but there's a movement to rename the street after the park, the historic park in the neighborhood, Emancipation Park. So we're shooting to rename the street Emancipation Avenue. So wish us luck. we're in big trouble in our neighborhood. The reasons that you just laid out, and the new group that we started, the Emancipation Economic Development Council, is really trying to figure out strategies. Because of course, with no zoning and very low planning, there's just no restrictions that would assure that you get those kind of that commercial corridor that becomes the main street where people can walk to get things, And it's really interesting. It's not a good thing, or it's really not a good thing for anyone. We had our first group of developers to come before our group 2 weeks ago because they wanted a variance on a property on Dowling Street in which they intend to put townhouses. And they were great, you know, to come before us and say, look. We think it's really great what you guys are trying to do in your community. You know, we agree with it. But as developers, you know, we're looking where the markets are and so on and so forth, and we get a sense that this is going to be an up-and-coming place. So we bought this property with no restrictions that said, you know, we could buy this and we could build our townhouses. That's the product that we do. So it's like, you know, we're not trying to be bad people. You know, we're just, you know, but now we've bought the property and now we're finding out that the rules of the, you know, that you guys are shifting the rules, and so it's really not fair to them, you know, that there's no guidance that kind of encourages them to do things, and then so you end up pitting, you know, developers against community folks when they really don't want to be pitted against each other. So we're trying to figure that out. But if you look at the replat maps that's happening along Dowling Street now, it's amazing. I mean, so much of the commercial, what used to be commercial. Is replatted for townhouse development, which then, of course, you know, that's going to feed into kind of the another version of Vickery Meadow, right? Where people they drive into their homes and then they have to drive out to go shop, to go to movies, to go do so on and so forth, as opposed to having some of those things where they are. Do you have one more?
With that, we're over time.
Okay.
So let's thank Rick Lowe for being here.